is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead me by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, oh. Your love and justice, God. You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation. And all your people sing along. Remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough, oh.
Still be seen if you wish.
If you want to ask.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he's my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide. Let the King of my heart be the wind inside myself, the anchor in the waves, oh, he's my song. Let the King of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days, oh, he's my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are. never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down. You are good, good.
Now is the time for us to share our joys and our sorrows with one another. I would like to begin by asking for your prayers for my sister, Cherry. She, as you know, has been in the senior citizen's home, but she's been isolated, and the family's not able to see her, and we really don't know what's going on. And we're happy that she is there. And my one sister went and saw her briefly and felt that they had not really been enabling her to walk or helping her to walk. And so she's having great difficulties walking. And so we're all very anxious and very concerned and not quite knowing what to do. And so if you keep her in prayer and family and those who are caring for her.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. It's always appropriate for us to give thanks to God for people new in our midst, even though they're not new, brand new in our midst. They're new in our midst during COVID. So we have Julia with us.
Yay!
Thank you, Jesus, for Julia. And Julia brought a her little keyboard, and so maybe we'll get to hear something a little bit later. We'll see. We'll see how the spirit moves.
I just gotta show it off.
It's beautiful. And we also have Jordan with us. Welcome, Jordan. Thank you, Jesus. Are there others?
Our friend, like an uncle. Rick, he just got out of the hospital, and he has a trach tube right now. He's having a difficult time. We anticipate it's cancer. We just don't know how far it's gone.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Julia.
I'd like to say thanks to my family and friends who know my love of music. And I always get shown that every birthday and every Christmas I get a special gift. And I just want to say thanks to the Lord for that, you know. And
thank you, Jesus.
I love music, you know, especially, you know, all kinds of music, like Christian music and noise.
Thank you, Jesus. And I believe your son got you that for your birthday,
yeah,
right?
My son.
Aww.
So, thank you, Jesus. I also want to thank Jesus for Lily and Selena joining us online.
Yay.
Thank you, Jesus. We love you. I'll try to go like this if you ever can't hear, and I'll make it work. I'll try. Are there others? Alicia and then Judy.
It's just for, you know, my home and for my and friends, and have a friend who's coming to visit next week. We haven't seen in a long time, so it'll be nice to see her. And then just prayers for, you know, I'm that's not very, you know, and so just prayers that, I don't know, we're so protected. And so people can, you know, with mom.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Yes, I just spent 10 days with my sister-in-law, Linda, and noticed when we were walking and doing things, she was having a really difficult time walking. And she called me last night, and I could tell by her voice that she was not good. And I asked her how it had been since she came back. She'd lost her husband a year and a half ago, and she's still suffering from that. And she started to cry, and she said, "I've just been crying every day since I've been home. So I'm worried about her getting depressed. And I don't know what to do for her."
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
I just want to lift up all the people who are dealing with the wildfires out west and the flooding in Germany and other places. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you, Jesus, for a kitchen which is being updated.
Yay.
And as we prepare to go into this congregational meeting next week, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer for guidance and wisdom and comfort and change. Lord, in your mercy. Are there any others?
Carol, I'm just going to say thank God for this beautiful day.
Thank you, Jesus.
And I just want to say thank God for the support of Presbytery that's helping us financially move into this next step. And Tracy, particularly Tracy Keenan, our associate executive, who's just really gone to bat for us over and over again. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Now, with all of these concerns in mind, let us say together the prayer. Gracious and merciful God,
hear our prayers for our loved ones who are sick, that they might be restored to health and strength, and those who are anxious and despairing might receive the blessings of courage and hope. Bless all who attend to their various needs, and we thank you for all the joys we have experienced and enhance the quality of our daily lives. Grant us grace to bless all those for whom we pray with steadfast devotion and goodwill. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Let us join together sloppily in the song we are learning together. We've come this far by faith. We've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He's never failed me yet. Oh, can't turn around. We've come this far, my faith. Amen, amen. Adrian, I'll invite you to lead us in our scripture.
We have two readings this morning. The first is from Mark 6, verses 30 to 34. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. And the second, from Matthew 10:27. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roots. These are the words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. The sermon is entitled On Christian Spirituality and is based on the scripture readings that were just read. I'm sure that you have all heard someone say, though I am not religious, I am spiritual. Since it is not self-evident what is meant by such a statement, we can only speculate that they probably are drawing a distinction between membership in some traditional religion, institutional religion, on the one hand, and a spiritual disposition on the other hand. Clearly, many such people think that spirituality pertains solely to the inner life of a person, namely the soul or the spirit. And accordingly, when they feel the need for refreshing that inner life, they often turn to private prayer, to solitary meditation, a retreat to a quiet space, or some other so-called discipline of the spirit. Now, the purpose of this sermon is to demonstrate that though Christian spirituality certainly involves the inner spirit, it also has a necessary social component, because humans are never alone in the world. The Bible makes this abundantly clear. In fact, the Jewish Christian tradition began with God taking the initiative to form a covenantal relationship with the people of Israel that was centered around a call to Moses to receive the Ten Commandments and to seal that relationship with God and the people, mutually promising their faithfulness to their newly found covenantal relationship. Further, in the Gospel of St. John and elsewhere, Jesus describes himself as a shepherd, which mirrors the beloved 23rd Psalm, where the writer depicts God as a shepherd. Certainly, the shepherd cares for all of his sheep equally. He has no favorites among them. The sheep know his voice and they follow him with complete confidence. The shepherd will willingly leave the whole flock in search for a lost one who gets caught in the bramble and is separated from the flock. Like a true prophet, the shepherd never leaves his flock astray, but always leads them to green pastures and cool waters. Always leads them to what is best for their well-being. But false prophets have always been in abundance, and their function is to proclaim lies and deceive their people. Since it is often difficult to distinguish false prophets from true prophets, the people can easily be deceived, as we have been witnessing here in America since the 2020 election. and most recently by the politicization of the COVID vaccine. False prophets declare fake news as truth, and the truth as fake news. And such has always been the case and remains so today. Now, in 1982, one of my graduate school friends and seminary colleagues, Reverend Dr. Richard Hain, exchanged 12 years of seminary teaching for a 17-year stint with Bread for the World. Bread for the World is a nonpartisan Christian advocacy organization that is based in the United States. The organization began in 1974, advocating for policy changes to end hunger and poverty, both in the United States and around the world. My friend recently wrote a book called We Carry the Fire, which was advertised recently in the Presbyterian Outlook magazine. It discusses Christian spirituality as the performance of a variety of social, political, and congregational actions that help restore health to families, to communities, to congregations. Actions that help restore wholeness to all of those groups. The book discusses numerous volunteers who staff countless charities that support poor people on a daily basis. They also lobby congressional representatives for effective legislation to combat the forces that perpetuate poverty and other forms of inequality. In all such places, the hopes and prayers of Christians are put into action. And that is the nature of Christian spirituality, to put into action our hopes and prayers for the well-being of God's people. Local grassroots organizations are democratic, moral, and spiritual practices that uplift all who participate. When Christ is at the center of that activity, it is Christian spirituality. The church is such a practice. Sparked by the mid-20th century civil rights movement, led by the learned Black preacher Martin Luther King Jr., numerous other moral and spiritual movements soon emerged. They include the nuclear disarmament movement, the feminist movement, the LGBTQ plus movement, the migrant farm workers movement, the environmental movement, the anti-Vietnam War movement, various decolonization and liberation movements, Black, womanist, Asian, African, Latin American theological movements, and many, many more. The aim of all of these was and remains to improve the quality of life for impoverished and oppressed peoples. All who participate in such organizations use their lives as means for improving the lives of others who are in need. There can be no activity that is more meaningful than making a difference in the lives of those who need it the most. And that is why the Bible is filled with stories about caring for the sick, the disabled, children, widows, the poor, the migrants, the persecuted, the prisoners, and the strangers. Those stories are not add-ons. They are not frills, but the essence of the gospel itself. It seems to me that the gospel universalizes nature's instinct to care for its offspring by motivating humans to care for and restore health to all of God's creation. The alternative is to do nothing and thereby witness the earth's steady decline towards death, the signs of which are abundantly present in our own daily lives. Clearly, the one positive thing we've all learned from the recent negative experience of the COVID-19 pandemic is a lesson that people sentenced to solitary confinement have known all along. And that is that isolation is inhumane, that we are created for community. We are created for one another. Thank God for telephones, for digital communication, and poorly paid essential workers who risk their lives in their daily work of helping others to live. We live today in perilous times, evidenced by greed, corruption, civil wars, power-hungry oligarchs, global starvation, homelessness, the continuing threat of COVID-19 and its variants, racial, ethnic, and gender hatred, continuing attacks on democratic structures at home and abroad, and much, much more. Who will show us the way to personal, national, and global health and well-being? I recommend the shepherd whom we have chosen to follow, Jesus of Nazareth, who said in John 10:27, "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me." How do you respond to these thoughts?
I'm going to move our online friends so that they can be seen and they can see us. Feel free to unmute if you'd like, online friends. Lily, Selena, hello.
The sermon reminded me of something my church in Boston is involved in, the Greater Boston Interfaith Organization. And so a few months ago, I led a Zoom house church meeting where about 10 of us got together on a Zoom call and answered the question, what is something that is a barrier to thriving for you or your neighbors? And people shared stories like, there's garbage on my street every day, or I have insane medical bills and all of these things. This happened across 50 faith communities, Christian, Jewish, and Muslim in Boston. And then we wrote down the topics that really resonated with people, and then we sent it on up the chains. And then each year, the ones that have the greatest resonance, we advocate for policy change. So last year, we advocated for the end of surprise medical bills and a $25 a month insulin cap. And it got passed, the $25 one. There's still, I think, surprise medical bills, but you know. And I think that that is something that really connects with your sermon, Peter, and like part of our faith is advocating for the thriving of our neighbors. It's working towards the betterment of everyone's lives around us. So that's what stirred it up in me. Thank you, Peter. What about others?
Well,
That reminds me of a story I heard on the radio this week, maybe somebody else did, of the United Church of Christ in D.C. area, and how they voted to give, I think they spent, I'm not going to remember, but like $75,000 to alleviate $5 million of debt, of medical debt, and for the people in their area. And it was anonymous. They got the names, they sent in the money. So in other words, if the person had gotten, $200,000, but the insurance or the debt collectors were willing to take $10,000.
That they worked it that way.
Then they paid off, and they just sent a letter to all these people saying, your debt has been relieved, and we did this because Jesus told us to, essentially. And the movement has gone from the D.C. area to a national movement of their church, the United Church of Christ. I think it's amazing.
Yeah, it's one of the biggest graces we have. It's awesome.
Are there others?
Well, I think that it's important to say because, I've been about, a lot of people say, pharmacy is bad, but I had to trust doctors with my disability, and I don't want to have church members come against me because of what I decided. But I figure if you're believing in Jesus and God, you're supposed to embrace every way that it comes, whether someone's for pharmacy, whether someone's against pharmacy for the sake of life. I don't think it's a good idea, medicating yourself for everything, but something like pre-diabetes that you can't help, you've tried every way, but I think these things, preventive medicine is okay, but I know other people might disagree, but I just hope that you won't judge me too much, because I didn't get the shot, and I got it, if I die because of it, I die because of it, I gotta think Jesus can protect me either way, and so that's what I did. But I like what the Bible has to say, because in times when you deal with these things, it's good to know to have grace, and then healing can come in any moment, even with, someone who has to break body rules, about the property issue, I guess you can come, it can come anyway,
Thank you, Julia. I got the vaccine as well, and as well as I think the majority of people in here, and I'm so grateful because I think that's the best way that I can love my neighbors, by not spreading the virus to them.
Yeah, and I show my son to trust and have faith. And my son to think about, when I do things.
Yeah.
I don't want him to have these so conspiracy theory like I've been all my life. I want him to go with the flow a little bit, but make his own battles too, for music and whatever he, like son, like mother, he already currently plays 3 instruments.
Any others?
I don't know, Peter, when I was listening to you, all I could feel was I was depressed. You were mentioning all these things that are going on in our world today. And it's just so depressing if you let it get you down, But if you focus on the things that you can do, even if they're small little things, to help a neighbor, help cook a meal for somebody, or just to do something that makes a difference. You can let go of that, of the worldly things that we feel we have no control over.
This is sort of anecdotal, but it's along those lines of little things. And most of you know that I quilt and sew, and a friend of mine said, Adrian, I have some fabric from a friend that she wants to give away. And I said, is it cotton? And she said, I think so. I said, sure, I'll take it. Well, she brought me two big bags. One was like four bolts of different kinds of flannel. And the other one, when I went in it, it was all these cut up pieces of fabric. And they were like about like this. And there'd be like eight pieces of one thing and then flannel to match. And it's probably like 300 of these things. And I was looking at them going, geez, I wonder what kind of pattern this is supposed to be, because the stuff didn't match. I mean, you know, it wasn't like colors that you would say, oh, I can see where this is going to be a quilt. At one point, I was going to look it up and say, okay, let me measure these pieces and see what kind of fabric. And so when I measured them, they were all 6 by 9. And I went, that sounds familiar. And then finally, at the bottom of the bag, 6 pieces of elastic fell out. And I said, oh my goodness, somebody went and cut up all this flannel and cotton to be made into minis. And I'm saying, they're seeding, you know, the sewing community to do this. And so I've already sent out some email to quilting friends. But if there's anybody who sews and would like some of these, because it looks like we're going to have to start wearing more masks again, let me know. And I will, you know, bring them around your house and give them to you, because there's no way I'm going to be making 300. And some of them are pretty nice. You know, oh, and by the way, there's some Bears fabric and there's some, what's the other team?
Chicago Bears.
It, what's the one in, is it Milwaukee?
Packers.
Packers. So if anybody knows any people in those areas or you're interested in making those and send, let me know. You can have all of them. Because I can't think of anybody who's interested. But, and so my question back to my friend who gave them to me was, the mystery to me is this person no longer able to sew? They had cut up all this stuff and they can't sew anymore. I hope they didn't do this in preparation and then pass. And I really hope they're seeding us. So I asked her to go back to her friend if she knows and find out what's going on. But in the meanwhile, please, if you want to make some masks, let me know. I will bring you some of this. So it's already cut 6 by 9. You just have to add your own, you know, nose pieces. And the stuff is already cut. All you have to do is put it together.
Thank you, Teresa.
Okay, let us now say together the prayer of thanksgiving. Gracious God, we rejoice in your action of calling us into the worship community.
Hear a church on me. Dedicated to affirming and helping all whom we encounter. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
And now let us still our minds and quiet our spirits as we prepare to commune with our God by eating the bread and drinking the wine in grateful remembrance of the suffering and triumph of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you'd like to, you can stand as we join together on the song on page 3. Good luck finding it.
All right, everybody.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of men and wrath of God has been, O Jesus, laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned. paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. And the Son says free, oh, it's free.
Together the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples at his Last Supper. On the night when he was betrayed,
and while they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." And they all drank it. When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
And now, as you feel led, we invite you to come down to take communion.
And come in two rows.
Yes, come in two rows.
Now let us say together the prayer. Gracious God, in the spirit of repentance
for our sins and wrongdoings, we thank you for the gift of salvation that we have received through the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant us the grace of forgiveness and the joy of being among your most faithful disciples this day and always.
Through
through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. And please rise as you are able and comfortable and join us for one last song, Rock of Ages, on page 4. And again, good luck finding the page.
Rock of Ages, left for me, let me hide myself through thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wound inside me flow. Rock of Ages, double cure, save from wrath.
An offering may do so in the basket at the back of the room. And now depart from one another in peace. And may the peace of God be with each of you today and every day.
Amen. 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 Please get some food. Please check out the newly painted kitchen. Please convince Julia to play a little thing on the piano unless she's sneaking out the door. And please come say hello to Lily, who's joining us on Zoom, and go in peace.
Amen. Hi, Lily.